I want to talk to you today about somebody's got to do it. Somebody's got to do it. Somebody's got to do it. And the story that you know so well expresses that so deeply. And that, of course, is David and Goliath. You know it by heart, but at the same time, it is just, I saw something. Matter of fact, I put a little tweet out, and as I did it, I said, I don't remember what I said, I just remember the end of it, that it's not going to happen on my watch. On my watch. Now, do you all realize this? That everyone is on a watch, meaning you're put here for a particular reason to accomplish a particular thing in a particular season. I mean, that's everybody. Now, you can sit there and not know what it is, but it doesn't change it. Whether you know it or not, doesn't change it. It doesn't change the fact that God Almighty sent you to earth at this time. And what you do with it is not God's fault. What you do with it is your fault. And because God will always help those who plug in to His abilities and those who believe Him and want Him to help them. So I was thinking about this, and I was thinking about this is, I'm on my watch. Don't know how long my watch will be, but you're on your watch too. Whatever you're doing with your life is your watch. It's your specific amount of time that you have here on this earth. Now, if I could get this to you, I don't know how to explain it to you to the degree that I feel it. I sincerely feel that if you could grab a handle on what it means to be on a watch. Now, those of you in the Army and stuff, I guess, would understand that. If they put you on a watch to watch something, to take care of something, to guard a particular area, to do something, that was your watch. The church needs to be on watch. The church we need to be protecting each other, looking after each other, helping each other. But again, because we have yet to understand, God Almighty has assigned you to a particular watch. You didn't just pop out down here. I mean, God knew you were coming before you showed up. Read Ecclesiastes, it says that. The spirit you came from God, you'll go back to God if you choose to. You make your decision to return to the Lord or not. But the deal I want you to think about again, no matter what age you are in, if you're still breathing, you're on a watch. And you cannot let that watch, you cannot miss your opportunity. You've got to be faithful. We've got to, what's going on? What do you want me to do? Well, what can I do? How can I be involved in this? You have no right to just formulate your life without the involvement of God in your life. A lot of people are in a lot of messes because you're doing that. So, but I saw, it became so clear to me, the idea of being on a watch. Now, in light of that, come on over to 1 Samuel 17. We start there with David and Goliath. And by the time you get down to verse 3, you remember they're fighting on each of the Philistines and the Israelites on two different sides of the mountain. In verse 3 of chapter 17, the Philistines stood on the mountain on one side, and the Israel stood on the mountain on the other side with a valley in between them. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines named Goliath, from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He's more than 9.5. Some people say 9.5 to 11 feet tall, based on who you're reading. He had a bronze helmet on his head. He was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze, about 200 to 250 pounds. And then he had this bronze javelin, and even it was about 15 pounds. Now, the staff of the spear was like a weaver's beam, and his iron spearhead weighed 600 shekels. I think that was worth about 15 pounds. And a shield bearer had to have somebody to carry the stuff. He stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, "Why have you come out to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and you the servants of Saul. Notice what he's saying. He did not say you're servants of God. Now, I could ask this question. Somebody looked at you, what would they say? Would they say, you're a servant of God? Or would they say, well, you're a servant of Whole Life? Are you a servant of the Baptist? Are you a servant of the Methodist? Are you a servant of the Catholics? Are you is that how they identify you? Or do they know you're a servant of the Most High God? Now, obviously, Goliath and the Israelites have obviously lost their glow about being a servant of God. Amen. So they're just seen as you're servants of Saul. Anybody paying attention? How somebody names you is very important. And it says, choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. Verse 9, if he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we'll be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you will be our servants and serve us. And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. When Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. I picture all of them hiding behind every rock in town. Hiding behind the mountain. Remember, they're both on a hillside, valleys in between. This big old bully is standing up there. You couldn't miss him if you wanted to. He's standing up there, and then he is defying the army of Israel. What he's really doing, nobody caught it. He's defying God. Israel had forgotten who they were. Somebody needs to hear me. Israel had forgotten. They had been out there for days. And for days he had been doing this, and not one person out of multiple thousands had risen up and said, we're not the servants of Saul. Not one person had risen up and said, you won't speak about my God that way. No one had said anything. Do you often wonder, like I do, you often wonder why in America or in situations and circumstances when all this craziness is going on, why no one says anything? Well, that just answered it right there. Oh, we can all talk to each other. We can talk about it behind closed doors, and we can carry on about it. No one did anything about it. They yelled, and they yelled. But the problem is that the Israelites were hiding behind rocks. So he comes on and he says, they all got scared and hid. So the men of Israel said, verse 25, have you seen this man who's come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel. They even knew it. Now I want you to pay attention. They knew it. They knew that the Philistines were an abomination to God. And they, the army of God, knew it and knew that he was defiling their God because they said so right there. It wasn't that they didn't know it. They did know it. They're telling David, this guy comes up to defile Israel. And it shall be that the man who kills him, the king will enrich with great riches, will give him his daughter, will give his father's house exemption in Israel. Then David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, what shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach? Look at him. And takes away the reproach from Israel. And they knew what would happen. They said, well, this is what will happen. It says, for who is this? And then David said, who is this uncircumcised idiot? Well, that's my interpretation. He says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? You know what happened? They forgot they belonged to God. They forgot this was not their battle. All they had to do was show up, but show up fully dressed. Show up with all the armor on. That's all they had to do. They didn't even have to pull the stupid trigger, if they had such a thing. They didn't have to do it. They just had to show up and watch God do it. They had to show up and done what they had seen happen with so many people, so many times, so many places. All they had to do and say, the battle belongs to the Lord. That's all they had to do. And stand tight. And stand tight. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. See, David was a different kind of man than the whole rest of the army. He was a man after God's own heart. The Bible says. It mattered to him what somebody said about his God. It mattered to one man, David. It mattered to one man. He says, you know, he shouldn't be talking about our God like this. And I'm sure a whole bunch of them had said something like that, but nobody had done anything. Just like there's not anybody in here. I guarantee you, if you've been paying attention to what God was doing, I mean, what's happening in our nation and what's happening across the world, there probably is not a single person that hadn't thought, dear God, what are we going to do? But how many people have volunteered for God? Here I am, use me. We've got too much to do. I mean, we got a barbecue, and we got to do this, and we got to do that, and we just got a new boat, and we got a new trailer, and we got two new cars and four new houses, and da 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 da. Somebody somewhere will do something, and then we'll send them a dollar in the mail. But you expect me to put myself out there? This is one of the most beautiful afghans you will ever have in your life. We wanted to open it up so you could see the full dynamics of it. I want to remind you that this design that the Lord gave me in an open vision back years ago in North Carolina, and with a dove flying through the air with healing streamers, the scriptures on the healing streamers, it's just precious. I saw people loose their faith and turn it loose as they grabbed hold of this. We've already prayed over it with oil from Israel. We've already anointed it with the oil, and we've already laid hands on it. So many people have. And we've had so many reports where people were able just to loose their faith as they grabbed hold of it. Plus, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's a product for this month. It's wonderful. You'd want many a person to have it. I keep it on my bed. It's beautiful. And guess what? It just puts you in the presence of God, and you wrap yourself in the Word of Almighty God. Is there not a cause? Is there not a cause? Let me ask you, church, is there not a cause? Are we just going to sit back? Is there not a cause? We're going to sit back and just talk about it, and then half of you don't even believe what you even know to be true. I don't want to hear anything. I don't want to know anything. Don't tell me. It's not politically correct. There's not anything politically correct at the moment. I'm not trying to be politically correct. I want to be biblically correct. So David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart fail because of him." Went to him and said, "Your servant, I'll go and I'll fight this Philistine." And Saul, you got to remember, Saul's the biggest guy in the land. He's head and shoulders above anybody. The biggest guy in the land. And here comes little David. And Saul said to David, "You're not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you're but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep his father's sheep. And when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it. I struck it, delivered the lamb from his mouth, and when it rose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck and killed it." I said, "Man, they don't bother me. Your servant has killed both lion and bear and this uncircumcised idiot." Philistine, enemy, liar, deceiver, enemy of God. Will be just like one of them, seeing as he has defiled the armies of the living God. "Moreover," David said, see, you get what you say. David just kept on talking. And he said, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he's going to deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." Now, David's telling the king that. He said, "We got this thing covered. Don't you even worry about it. We got it. Got it. And so Saul says, well, go and the Lord be with you. So then Saul says, well, if you're going to do this, you're going to need a bigger hat, and you're going to need a bigger sword, and you need a bigger gun, and you need a tank. And we happen to have one, and you put on all this stuff, then we're going to send you out there. Notice now, no one said, we'll go with you. Did you notice that? No one said, don't worry. Hallelujah, you're brave. Thank God for you. We're behind you, brother. No one. No one said, we will back you up. And so here we are. And David said, man, I can't wear this mess. He says, this hasn't been tried for me. He said, I can't walk with these things. I hadn't tested them. So David threw them down. Then he took his staff in his hand, chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook. There's a messages galore in all of this, but that my point is, stay with me. Somebody's got to do this. Not trying to go all those directions. Took 5 smooth stones from the brook, put them in a shepherd's bag, in a pouch, which he had, and his sling, which was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. He didn't say, I'm over here. So he got his little, put his little rock in there, got his little sling, and started going to where the enemy was. Amen. No one went with him. No one back. We have an army of Israel. No one went with him. No one. And said, and when the Philistine looked at that and saw David, he disdained. He hated him to start off with. He said, the nerve of you runt to come out here. For he was a youth, ruddy, and good-looking. Good-looking runt. So the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with a stick? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give you flesh, your flesh, to the birds of the air and the beast of the field. Then David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword, with a spear, with a javelin, I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of heaven, whom you have defiled. In other words, big boy, you've made a mistake. You defile my God. I know who he is, whether the rest of y'all do or not. I know who my God really is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand. I will strike you and take your head from you. He didn't have anything but a rock. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air, the wild beasts of the earth, that all men may know that there is a God in heaven. Now get his reasoning. His whole point is, I'm fighting for God. You have insulted my God. And David says, use me. Here am I, send me. I'll go. I know God will take care of me. Of course, you've heard me say it many a times. I'm sure he was always saying, dear God, you're so big, how could I miss you? 9.5, 11 feet. Huge guy. Got 5 rocks, surely I can hit you somewhere. Plus the guy was covered with all this stuff. Don't forget, no one went with him. Amen. Just like very few understand the meaning of what's about to happen in a nation. Very few are paying attention, and very few are understanding that only the church can change it. And it was so when the Philistine arose and came and drew it out to meet David, that David hastened. I mean, he ran to the enemy. Then David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and it struck the Philistine in his forehead so that the stone sank in his forehead and he fell on his face to the earth. He killed that guy. Therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his own sword, drew it out of the sheath. He couldn't even hardly hold the thing. and killed him and cut off his head. Well, picked his head up. Can you imagine how much the head may have weighed? Picked up the head and carried it into Saul. And David stuck his little weapons back over in his tent. He used them later on. Don't let the times define you. You define your season. You make up your mind which side you're on. Don't let your hurts from past churches or past Christians keep you from running to the front of the battle line. There will always be people who will hurt you when you wear your feelings on your shoulders. There's always somebody to come and flick it off. Always. Always. This is what David did. He defined his terms. He considered the problem. Some of you need to consider the problem that America is in. He considered the problem. He was not going to let the enemy absolutely defile his God. David knew what God had done for him in the past. How many of you in here? Oh, if I were to ask you, how many of you been here over the Lord? Every hand would go up. How many of you seen God get you out of something? Every hand would go up. How many of you believe that God's working for it? Every hand would go up. But then what makes what we're facing now bigger than what we faced at that moment? If God did it one time, God's going to do it again. But somebody's got to give him a platform. Somebody's got to give yourself to him. Here am I. Send me. Use me. Send me. Yes. Well, I don't know what I can do. He didn't ask David what he could do. David just did what he could do. And then God took the rock. Now, David was not that good of a shot. Come on. The guy had all kind of armor on. God grabbed hold of that rock. I've said it many times. David could have just thrown it behind him, and God would have turn that thing around, because he gave himself to be used. And God guided that rock, and it went bam, right in between. One little place right there where they didn't quite meet. And Goliath was dead from one rock. Shot by a youngster. For the reason, not because he wanted to get the wife, not because he wanted the money, but because the idea, the audacity, the audacity to stand against my God. Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Well, I think we should be quiet and not say anything. We don't want to stir up nothing. Oh, really? Everybody else stirring up something, why don't you stir too? Stand up for your God. Don't let hell make a mockery of your God. Well, the amens are getting smaller. I need to, can't see. Let me tell you what he had to do. Most of our giants in our land are a result of our past decisions and our failures. When they were small, we could have done something with them. David had to face criticism and rejection. You know the ones who criticized him? All those who said they belonged to God. Still nobody helped him. You know, you better forget about following the majority. God's word always comes true. See, David knew that his God was bigger than that giant. And he also knew that you better not defile God Almighty. He knew there's a payday someday. If you see the big picture and you see what's happening, somebody will say, count me in. But you can't hide behind a rock and expect it to happen. You got to say, count me in. Count me in. Count me in. This is our defining moment. This is our defining moment. It's going to take everything we have. It's going to take more than we have. But God's going to multiply what we have. Amen. He's going to do it for us. This is one of the most beautiful afghans you will ever have in your life. We wanted to open it up so you could see the full dynamics of it. I want to remind you that this design that the Lord gave me in an open vision back years ago in North Carolina, and with a dove flying through the air with healing streamers, the scriptures with on the healing streamers, it's just precious. I saw people loose their faith and turn it loose as they grabbed hold of this. We've already prayed over it with oil from Israel. We've already anointed it with the oil, and we've already laid hands on it. So many people have. And we've had so many reports where people were able just to loose their faith as they grabbed hold of it. Plus, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's our product for this month. It's wonderful. You'd want many a person to have it. I keep it on my bed. It's beautiful. And guess what? It just puts you in the presence of God, and you wrap yourself in the Word of Almighty God. Oh my goodness, you and I have to be the person. Somebody's got to do it, I'm telling you. Oh man, can you imagine David out there? And he said, man, I've got to take this big old giant down. He's too big, as I said in the message. He's too big to miss. And you and I have a call on our lives to let people know what Jesus has done in our lives, and we've got to let them know about it. Oh, this is your moment. This is your time. It's my time. I believe the power of God to involve people in the kingdom of God has just fallen upon God's people like never before. And I know you love the Afghan. Isn't it wonderful? I just adore it. And you will too. And it's got the scripture. We put oil on it and prayed over it. So many people have. We've gotten so many results. There's nothing special except it's beautiful and God gave it to me by a vision. But I'm here to tell you, we've gotten wonderful results and nothing like wrapping yourself up in it. I hope you'll come to visit us if you're ever in the Augusta area. And let me remind you, keep up with us on sandrakennedy.org and all the many social media avenues. Keep up with us and find out what's happening and what's going on. God's doing miracles here. We're seeing outstanding miracles take place. We love you. We'd love for you to partner with us. We're here for you. My people, answer the phone. Not mine. They're God's people. They're alive unto the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody's got to do it.